anyone on TV. So the A-Team is, we were a very silly show. Now you know why. Mr. T is sillier than I am. George Peppard was not silly, but he was irreverent and cynical. And he was Hannibal. He liked to see people, he loved to cackle and laugh and to manipulate. That's Hannibal. And Mr. T was the silliest of us all. And Dwight was here last year. You heard him. A really smart guy. He's a little, you know, off. So it was great. We're all goofy. And that came across. We wanted the show to be for children. And you've all grown up. And it's always wonderful to see you. When I talk to you, I can tell you were 6, 7, 8 years old. And or sometimes I meet the parents who are now, you know, my age, right? A little older. But it's wonderful. I didn't know this was going to happen, but we did know we were making a show for a family. And we always were thinking of 6, 7, 8-year-olds. We used to say 8-year-olds, 8 to 80. So we were very conscious of doing things that kids would laugh at. We also knew we were making a male show. We got that network hated us because we were very masculine, you know. We were a show in a show. We were politically incorrect, so we were hated in Hollywood. The A-Team was. Maybe say that. I could go on for hours. But if I write a book, I'll tell all the stories. But because it was all guys, there was no, the women only came on so Faceman would have somebody to save and flirt with, and you know, it was chauvinistic. You cannot do that today. On TV, well, you look here, all the stars are all these beautiful ladies. I mean, there are no men on television today in shows that are from the male perspective of the world. It all comes from the other side of the brain, which is all right, but, you know, there will never be another A-Team. So when they were like we made it, because it was four guys and guns and cigars and womanizing and wrestling, we were always right. The new Battlestar Galactica, you notice, there was no right and wrong. There was just gray area. You didn't know who the Cylons were the good, and the humans were the evil. That's the world we live in today, because it's politically incorrect to say those people are evil and we're not. You know, that's a moral judgment. Well, the fact is, some people are evil and some people are good. So those, you know, Battlestar Galactica was based on that, and A-Team was very much about good guys getting the bad guys, and that's very, that's really not politically done. And the smoking, I mean, Jesus, God, I got my cigar right there. I never travel anywhere without my cigars. And I don't go out anymore. I don't go to dinner. I don't go to bars. Because I can't smoke. So I'm boycotting the world. I always carry my cigars with me, just in case I get lucky and somebody says, fire it up. But anyway, so the new A-Team, and they made Faceman the star of the show because the way Hollywood, because Bradley Cooper is one of the hottest stars in Hollywood today. And so they made him up front. But the A-Team was ensemble. We're all the same. It was a team. So in other words, A-Team movie has nothing to do with the A-Team TV show, and did it without a Cyclopedia. That's the way the world works. You cannot remake those shows because they are another. One is politically conservative, which is the old shows, both of them. The others are to the left. They're all leftist, socialist shows. The one reason you like the A-Team is because we were a Ronald Reagan, Republican, conservative show. And you can't find that anymore. It's unpopular. It's not done. You can't do it. So, one more.
Time is Benedict.
My time's not up.
Mine is. We have any future projects?
I have a future project? No, not really. I'm going to get one, though. I'll get one. I should have one, shouldn't I? Just for moments like this.
I know.
I'm kind of wasting my life. The problem is, I'm a nature solitary person, and I'm a thinker. I like to think and ponder. I spend all my time thinking and It's very unusual for actors, because actors generally are not. They're acting, act. But I, by nature, I like to sit back and think and talk. So, it's, acting was a big mistake in my life, but it happened, and I had success, and I just went off on that tangent. I don't regret it, because I had a fantastic experience. But in terms of what I was meant to do in this lifetime, well, it's okay. I think of that as okay. But I spent the last 15 years raising my children. I quit Hollywood in 94. Well, we quit each other, but I didn't want to miss my kids' childhood. So when they were 4 and 6, I left, and I was a single dad, and I raised them myself. It's the only thing I've done in my life of which I'm proud. They're two really wonderful human beings, very unique and mature, and they're fantastic. But I put a lot of my of time and effort and creativity and energy into them. I did all the cooking, all the cleaning, all the washing up, all the thing. This is the greatest job I ever had, the toughest job I ever had. And I'm an expert on it now, so most of my friends in Montana where I now live are moms. Now I'm they're gone and they're living their life, so I'm good. I don't know what I'm going to do. Last year I worked in England. I did a play and a musical because I started on the stage. I want to write a book. And then after that, I don't know.
Well, in conclusion.
I'm done. I'm finished. In conclusion. No. Who's next, by the way? No. I only had a half. Don't touch me. Huh? You want? No, this is the guy who gives me my medicine. I'm on medicine.
Scotch is not
taking my supplier. I should have said
that. I'm your supplier. Anyway, in parting, what's your secret to your energy? Because you remain not young, but youthful, but energetic, like we've seen today. What's your secret?
I know. I have a bunch of secrets. No, I have. It's really good boiling down to a couple of things. You know, my whole life has been focused on finding the truth. I mean, that sounds like silly. I used to ask my dad when I was 10 years old, what's the truth? Because there was the left and there was the right, or there was some people thought this or something. It was always relative, and I thought, absolute truth. What's the absolute truth? So I was a search, and I found it. I know what it is, but it's hard to talk about because, it's the thing that anybody with a spiritual journey, eventually you get to it because, and then you let go of everything, really, and life becomes pretty difficult to live because you don't really care about material things, but you're still living in that world, so. But so that's part of it. It's letting go. And, you know, when I was young, I was sick. I had cancer. And I'll make this short. I had cancer, and I said, but modern medicine gave up on me, and I suspected it anyway. So I got into using food as medicine. So I changed completely the way I ate. I ended up writing a book about it, Confessions of a Kamikaze Cowboy, which I wrote when I was living the 18. It's still completely true in terms of the philosophy and the journey that I took, and it tells growing up on meat and tripping in Montana on ranches and stuff, and then what I was led to. So to get rid of tumors, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So part of my energy comes from the basic, belief, faith that most of what we are is what we eat. Because food is not just material energy, it's not just calories, it's spiritual food, really. I know it gets a little freaky-deaky, but eating junk food does more than put on weight. You know, it damages your psyche, your soul. It's not good. So I gave all that up. I eat whole foods, whole experience. So I eat really simple, actually, at home. I eat grains and beans and lots of traditional Eastern things. And I quit eating meat in 1972, so it's been a long journey. So that's part of it. My brother looks, I have a brother who looks like he's my father. So it's not a genetic thing. I do have good genes, you know. These aren't them, actually, but they're at home. And I was blessed with good genes, but food and raising my sons, because I had children when I was, my first son was born, he's 43. So I've been playing basketball and soccer and skiing and just with my kids. Excuse me. So very physically active. And my children, who I raised, you know, for them, they get up in the morning and have miso soup. You know, miso soup with tofu and seaweed and scallions. And they grow up without junk food. But when they got to a certain age, they noticed that their dad, who was the same age as their friend's granddad, had more energy than their friend's dad. I mean, I actually have an older son who's 42, who came into my life when he was 28, you know. Hello? Are you Dirk Bentley? Yeah. I think you're my dad. Ah, get out. No, really, that's another great story, which I would love to tell. So anyway, playing with my children, raising boys and being physically active, it kept me young, it kept me in their world, and you ever stay young, so I don't know. And also having Fred Astaire as a friend didn't hurt. I met him, you know, he played my dad on Battlestar Galactica. It would have been great, you know, they could have, and when they did the new show, they had Fred Astaire, who was my Starbucks dad. Then they had me. In the new one, they should have, where I was like Fred Astaire, and then Fred Astaire's grandson or granddaughter. That's what Tom DeSanto, who did the X-Men, and I met with him. And he had built all the sets, you know, up in Vancouver. We were all set to go. I met with Tom DeSanto, the usual suspects in X-Men, with Bryan Singer, and they were going to do the Battlestar Galactica, and it was going to be set 25 years later. And Starbucks there, 50 years old, 55 years old, and he's sitting. Fantastic. And one of my dreams was to play Starbuck like I am now. You know, the same. But I told Tom, I said, I want to show the sadness, the pathos of somebody, of a guy like Starbuck. How that ends up, you know, that Peter, he's alone. He's still alone. He's still chasing girls. So he doesn't have a family. And then they said, that's what we're doing, that's what we want to show. And we're thinking, I said, oh, yeah. So there he is, smoking the funeral rolls, and then in the show, he finds out that one of the Viper pilots is his daughter, from that one I did, you know, back in 1980, when I sent my daughter off on the rocket. I had, you know, so that would have been great. But Fred Astaire, he was very lively. We talked about food, and of course he didn't. He wasn't as far out as me, but he ate minimal. The other thing is calories. Fewer calories, you eat, the better. The human body doesn't need more than 1,500 calories, especially when you're over 40. When you're young, depends on what you do. This is the thing. Everybody eats the same. Women should eat different from men. They used to. When I was a kid, my mother, her dad, they ate steak. A woman didn't sit down and carve up a steak. Now, you know, a hamburger, and there was no fast food. We consume in America, I don't know here, but the kilos of meat per person in America from the 1920s up till now is gone like, because the fast food changed everything. And that's why we have all these cancers, all these tumors, all these diseases showing up. Forget obesity and overweight. All food. It's not exercise. It's not. It's just what we eat. Period. End of story. We don't need to raise more money for breast cancer. All this stuff. We need more money. We don't need any more goddamn money. And the money that's being raised is being raised by the people that cause the cancer. So don't get me started. But I'm not alone on it. Fred Astaire agreed with me. And Gloria Swanson, you won't know her, but she was the biggest movie star I ever knew. So there you go. That's my secret.
Thank you for...
All right, kids. Thanks for making an old guy happy.